Hello everyone and welcome back to the virtual revision class of Network and Cybersecurity 15 EC 835. So today we will be going through the last concepts of module 3, which is IP security. So as you all know, in the previous classes we have completed revising IP security overview, IP security policy and encapsulating security payload. So today we will complete revision on the rest two parts, which is combining security associations and Internet Key Exchange or IKE. Moving on to combining security associations. Now we know that the SAs or security associations can implement either AH, that is authentication header, or ESP, which is nothing but encapsulating security payload. But in case we want to implement both, what we need to do is we need to combine the SAs in, and this can be done by number one, forming a security association bundle where the term security association refers to a sequence of SAs through which traffic must be processed to provide a desired set of IPsec services. Also, the SAs in a bundle may terminate at different or same endpoints. Now, this security associations may be combined into bundles in again two ways. Number one, by transport adjacency, and number two, iterated tunneling. But one interesting issue that arises when considering SA bundles is that the order in which the authentication and encryption may be applied between a given pair of endpoints and the ways of doing so. Having said that, now let us look into transport adjacency and iterated tunneling in detail. So, transport adjacency refers to applying more than one security protocol to the same IP packet. So, if you have a same or one IP packet, we are going to apply not a single security protocol but multiple protocols to it, that too without invoking tunneling. Now this approach to combining AH and ESP allows for only one level of combination, and further nesting yields no added benefit since the processing is performed at one IPsec instance, which is the ultimate destination. The next, iterated tunneling, which refers to the application of multiple layers of security protocols effected through IP tunneling. Now this approach allows for multiple levels of nesting since each tunnel can originate or terminate at a different IPsec site along the path. Now this encryption and authentication can be combined in order to transmit an IP packet that has both confidentiality and authentication between two hosts. So here we look at several approaches. That is, first we have ESP with authentication option. So in this approach, the user first applies ESP to the data to be protected and then appends the authentication data field. There are actually two sub cases here, namely transport mode ESP and tunnel mode ESP. And this we have already covered in the previous videos with the meaning and operation. Next we have transport adjacency, which is another way to apply authentication after encryption. So what is done in transport adjacency is that we use two bundled transport SAs, with the inner being an ESP SA and the outer being an AH SA. So what we are doing, we are using two bundled transport SAs, one inner being an ESP SA and outer bundle, which is nothing but your AH SA. And here ESP is used without authentication option. Now the advantage of this approach over simply using a single ESP SA with the ESP authentication option is that the authentication covers more fields, including the source and destination IP addresses. However, the disadvantage is the overhead of the two SAs versus one single SA or security association. Now, in transport tunnel bundle, again authentication before encryption is done by applying authentication before encryption between two hosts by using a bundle consisting of an inner AH transport SA and an outer ESP tunnel SA. So as I said, there are two SAs, one inner AH transport SA and an outer ESP tunnel SA. Coming towards the advantages of this approach, the advantages are, now first, because the authentication data are protected by encryption, it is impossible for anyone to intercept the message and alter the authenticated data without detection. Secondly, that is the second advantage, is it may be desirable to store the authentication information with the message at the destination for later reference. So this was about transport tunnel bundle, which combines basically two SAs. Next we have basic combinations of security associations. So now the IPsec architecture document lists four examples of combinations of SAs that must be supported by compliant IPsec hosts like workstations and servers or security gateways, example firewalls or routers. Now these are all illustrated in figure A, where the lower part of each case in the figure represents the physical connectivity of the elements and the upper part represents logical connectivity via one or more nested SAs. So each SA can be either AH or ESP. For host-to-host SAs, the mode may be either transport or tunnel, otherwise it must be explicitly a tunnel mode only. Now let us discuss each of the four cases in detail. Starting with case 1, here all security is provided between end systems that implement the IPsec. For any two end systems to communicate via an SA or security association, they must share the appropriate secret keys. Now among the possible combinations are AH in transport mode, next ESP in transport mode, C ESP followed by AH in transport mode, that is ESP SA inside and AH SA, and lastly anyone of A, B or C inside an AH or ESP in tunnel mode. We have already discussed how these various combinations can be used to support authentication, encryption, authentication before encryption and authentication after encryption. So this was about case 1 in basic combinations of security association. Next we have case 2. Now in case 2, security is provided only between the gateways, which is nothing but routers, firewalls, etc., and no hosts implement IPsec. So what happens in case 2? Security is provided between the gateways and the host do not implement IPsec. Nextly, the case illustrates simple virtual private network support. The security architecture document specifies that only a single tunnel SA is needed for this case. As you can see, only a single tunnel SA here. Then the tunnel could support AH, ESP or ESP with the authentication option, that is ESP with AH. Here nested tunnels are not required because the IPsec services apply to the entire inner packet since tunnel mode is used. Moving on to case 3, this builds on case 2, that means the case 3 builds on case 2 by adding end-to-end security. The same combinations which were discussed for cases 1 and 2 are allowed here. The gateway-to-gateway tunnel provides either authentication, confidentiality or both for all traffic between the end systems. Next, when the gateway-to-gateway tunnel is ESP, it also provides a limited form of traffic confidentiality. Lastly, individual hosts can implement any additional IPsec services required for given applications or given users by means of end-to-end SAs or security associations. So this was about case 3. Lastly, we have case 4. And in case 4, what happens is, this provides support for a remote host that uses the internet to reach an organization's firewall and then to gain access to some server or workstation behind the firewall, as you can see here in this figure. Now, only tunnel mode is required between the remote host and the firewall. As in case 1, one or two SAs may be used between the remote host and the local host, which is again as illustrated in this particular figure. So this was about case 4 in basic combinations of security associations. So lastly, we have the Internet Key Exchange or IKE, and in this we will be discussing the header and payload formats of IKE. Let us first see the IKE header format. Now, when you have an IKE message, that message consists of two things. One is IKE header, which is in turn followed by one or more payloads. And this entire thing, that is the entire message, is carried in a transport protocol. Now, the figure here shows the header format for an IKE message. Now, this basically consists of the following fields. That means the format, which is the header format for IKE, consists of the following fields. Firstly, we have the initiator SPI, which is of 64 bits. Now, this is a value which is chosen by the initiator to identify a unique IKE security association or SA. Next, we have the responder SPI, which is again of 64 bits, and this value is chosen by the responder to identify a unique IKE SA or security association. So, as the name itself suggests, the initiator's SPI is chosen by the initiator and the responder's SPI is chosen by the responder. Then we have the next payload field, which is of 8 bits, and this indicates the type of first payload in the message. Next we have major version and minor version, which is of 4 bits and indicates the major version and minor version of IKE which is in use. Then we have the exchange type, which is again of 8 bits, and this bit indicates the type of exchange. Next is flags, which is again of 8 bits, and this field indicates specific options set for the IKE exchange. Then we have the message ID, which is again of 32 bits, and this is used to control retransmission of lost packets and matching of requests and responses. And lastly, we have the length of 32 bits, and this field indicates the length of total message, that is header plus all the payloads. Next, we have the IKE payload. Now, as you can see in the figure, the payload format consists of the next payload field. Now, the value in this next payload field is 0 if this is the last payload in the message. Otherwise, its value is the type of the next payload. The next field is C, which is nothing but critical bit. Now, this critical bit is 0 if the sender wants the recipient to skip the payload. It is set to 1, however, if the sender wants the recipient to reject this entire message. The next field is reserved and it is used for future use. However, the last field, which is the payload length field, it indicates the length in octets of this payload, including the generic payload header. Then next, you have the table that basically summarizes the payload types defined for IKE and lists the fields or parameters that are part of each payload. So as you can see in this table, it has two columns. The first column represents the type of the payload and the second column represents the parameters which are corresponding to each payload. So the first payload type is security association, which is used to begin the establishment of an SA. Now the payload has a complex and hierarchical structure. Similarly, the next type, which is the key exchange payload, can be used for a variety of key exchange techniques, namely Oakley, Diffie-Hellman, and the RSA-based key exchange using PGP. Similarly, we have identification type, which contains the ID type and ID data. Then there is certificate type, which transfers a public key certificate, and so on and so forth. You have the various types and parameters associated with it. So finally, this marks the end of module 3. We shall continue with the revision of module 4 in the next class. Thank you.